Thank you very much. Thank you for the kind invitation. I'm going to share with you some of the recent experience, ours and others, about the use of this type of cell therapy, which is completely different in the concept than the previous one that we just heard, since here we do not have, we do not aim to any reconstitution of the immune system, but mostly to trophic, neurotrophic, neuroregenerative effects, and maybe some local immunomodulation. Here are my disclosures. First of all, I want to answer this question, which may be raised to any one of us. If we have, at this moment, at least 12 effective, some very effective treatments in multiple sclerosis, then why do we need cell therapy? Why do we need stem cells? And the answer is simple, and it's double. First of all, because of this continuing continuing atrophy and loss of the neurons and the axons, which shrinks the brain. This does not happen only in the, happens in the beginning, but also at the earlier or intermediate stages of multiple sclerosis. So we do not have a good answer to this atrophy, although some of the medications partially affect the progression of this atrophy. Second, this localized or compartmentalized inflammation, which is probably one of the reasons for the progression of multiple sclerosis, either in the cortex or in the deep gray matter, sometimes in follicles below the meninges or in other areas of the white matter. And all of these are related to a better, to a worse prognosis and more deterioration in the progressive phase of multiple sclerosis. So for these two parameters of the disease activity, we do not have a very good and efficient ways to confirm. We can see another example about this localized inflammation. It was mentioned, I think, in the, one of the previous questions. What happens in the oligoclonal production, the oligoclonal antibodies, the intrathecal production of antibodies into the cerebrospinal fluid? And most, in one of the reviews, most of the medications only very partially affect the presence of the oligoclonal antibodies, even if the treatments are very, very effective. So the changes are either minor or not at all. And even with more severe immunosuppressive medications like lemtuzumab, or even with autologous transplantation, in most of the trials, the presence of oligoclonal bands in the CSF continues to be there. And even when the treatment of like rituximab, which is directly targeting the B cells, is given intrathecally, still there is the presence of oligoclonal antibodies doesn't seem to change, at least in the long term, which raises the important question that what happens with this localized inflammation, and probably with our limited efficacy with the currently existing immunotherapies for multiple sclerosis. So these are the two major unmet needs in the treatment of multiple sclerosis, especially the progressive phases of the disease, that we have this progression of irreversible and axonal damage and atrophy, and we have this compartmentalized or localized inflammation, which probably continues to exist, and through memory cells, we see it as one of the expressions of the production of oligoclonal antibodies into the cerebrospinal fluid. So one of the possible approaches for these two unmet needs for multiple sclerosis could be stem cells, and because we have this limited efficacy, this limited ability for regeneration due to all these possible factors and this continuation of inflammation in the CSF. What the stem cells can do, they could probably induce regeneration, or they can do protection by rescuing the damaged cells. So they have these neuroprotective and neurotrophic effects theoretically, but they also, and this is very important, they may serve as vehicles, possibly after migration, targeting specifically in situ this compartmentalized inflammation and inducing localized and not only peripheral immunomodulation. So we know that there are different types of stem cells, including the prototype of them, which is the embryonic stem cells, but also some somatic ones, and stem cells which can be induced by fibroblasts by genetic manipulation. So there are different options for using stem cells in this disease and others as well. But what they have in common, all these types of stem cells, they have a triple mechanism of action at different degrees for each type of stem cells. First of all, possible cell replacement, which works very well in animal models by producing new neuronal cells. And this works mostly for the embryonic stem cells and the neuronal stem cells. Sometimes it's not exactly replacement, but cell fusion or rejuvenation by the transfer of mitochondria, for instance. Second, neurotrophic and neuroprotective effects by the production probably of growth factors. And third, and this is very important, the immunomodulatory properties of stem cells, which is a rather new discovery. And some of the people here, including Professor Martino and Tamir Ben-Hur and us, were involved in these publications. So if we take this triple mechanism of action, triple or this four mechanism of action of stem cells, then we have all these candidate diseases. And it's good to see that multiple sclerosis offers a very good candidate disease because we can utilize all these possible mechanisms of action of stem cells for the disease. And the preclinical proof of concept, that's just a very, very tiny example of the papers. There are about a little less than 10,000 papers with stem cells on all kinds of neurological models, and most of them with very good results in different models of neurological diseases. Few examples, and fast, the pivotal work from Professor Martino using adult neuronal stem cells transplantation and having good suppression in EAE back in 2003. And in parallel, almost in parallel, Professor Ben-Hur, in collaboration with our group, where he saw that the intrathecal injection of neuronal stem cells could suppress chronic EAE and induce protection of demyelination axonal damage. What was important, there was an increase in neurogenesis in the transplanted animals, and a good migration of the cells, as shown by the MRI, using paramagnetic material, Faridex in this case, where you see the stem cells migrating in the areas of the white matter lesions, or by staining with the human mitochondria. However, there is a problem after the injection, the intrathecal injection of stem cells. They do not survive forever. So in this follow-up work, when we leave the cells for 1 month or more, and then we give a boost induction for EAE, we see that there is a relapse, which means that these animals are not protected 1 month after the injection of the initial injection of stem cells, and indicating that it might be that we need multiple injections in order to continue this beneficial effect. So all these adult stem cells can be obtained from different tissues of our body, but bone marrow is the biggest, the richest source of stem cells in our body. Of course, 99% is hematopoietic, but there is also another population, these mesenchymal stem cells, which look like fibroblasts, completely different than hematopoietic stem cells, for which we heard earlier, and they have different markers. These mesenchymal stem cells initially were called stromal stem cells because the hematologists thought that they are only here to support hematopoiesis or to support the production of the hematopoietic stem cells. They work. But their default proliferation and the differentiation is towards mesodermal tissues, like producing bones. They produce chondrocytes and adipocytes if we leave them by default with a regular culture medium in the in vitro cultures. But those mesenchymal stem cells, similarly to the other types of stem cells that I were mentioned, have also additional properties. They have neuroprotective, immunomodulating, and possibly transdifferentiation abilities. So, for instance, if we take mesenchymal stem cells in a culture of neuronal cells, then we see that retinoic acid, which is a very good food for those cells, can be replaced instead of this by the supernatant of mesenchymal stem cells with similar results, or if we induce a damage to the neuronal cells by H2O2, then we have a significant degrees of apoptosis with the addition of mesenchymal stem cells. We almost prevent this apoptosis induced by H2O2 in the neuronal stem cells. In vitro, at least, it is possible to, with a special medium, to induce transdifferentiation to different types of the neuronal lineage, including oligodendrocyte neurons and astrocytes, at least in terms of the expression of the molecules, or the expression, the surface molecules, or the expression of specific enzymes that are related, like the tyrosine hydroxylase, that are related to the function of neurons. They produce dopamine, or the PSD95, which is a specific protein for the dendrites and the synapses. For mesenchymal stem cells, the results in the animal model of EAE, here the experiment performed by intravenous injection by the group of Antonio Uccelli, showed that there is a good suppression of the disease, but when the cells were injected intravenously, indicating that mainly the mechanism is of this of the peripheral immunomodulation. However, in parallel experiments from our group, we found that there is an additional benefit by the intraventricular or intrathecal injection of those mesenchymal stem cells, both in terms of the clinical results and of histopathology, inducing a survival of more than 95% of the axons when the cells are injected intrathecally. And other works, like those from New York, from Saud Sadiq, showed that multiple injections of stem cells can be even more beneficial of mesenchymal stem cells in the model of chronic EAE. What is more important, it's not only that mesenchymal stem cells can be affected, but as far as we try to neuralize them in a way by, for instance, by this protocol for brainstorm, by inducing the production of growth factors, then the results are slightly better in the model of EAE, and the migration of cells even better. But even in models which are not inflammatory, like the Cuprizone model of demyelination, there are some good effects in induction of remyelination when we inject mesenchymal stem cells. All these are the indications for a good efficacy of possible a basis for the rationale of using this type of stem cells in multiple sclerosis. But before applying this such a treatment, we have to test also, we had to test what happens when we take from a patient the bone marrow mesenchymal stem cells, and we can see that fortunately there are no significant differences in any of the immunomodulatory or neurotrophic effects of those cells when they were taken from multiple sclerosis patients, ALS patients, or healthy individuals. So bone marrow mesenchymal stem cells offer these practical advantages for clinical usages. They can be obtained from the adult bone marrow, they can be easily cultured and expanded in high numbers, and they can be injected autologously, so we do not need a donor, we do not need any immunosuppression to prevent rejection, and they do have similar, or maybe at a lesser degree, but they have similar actions in terms of immunomodulation and neuroprotection as compared to other types of stem cells. Most importantly, they have very, very low dangers for potential malignant transformation. So how this was translated to the bedside, all this preclinical information, and we can see that during the last years, there are more than 500 clinical trials only in neurological diseases. And in two-thirds of the studies, the type of stem cells used are the mesenchymal stem cells around the globe. For instance, some examples, not specifically for multiple sclerosis, but we can learn about this. A paper published from the Korean group and published in Annals of Neurology a few years ago. In multiple system atrophy, the injection into the carotid artery of mesenchymal stem cells induced a slowdown of the progression of multiple system atrophy, and then the clinical score went up, and a new injection of the stem cells induced a further improvement. But there were also some side effects, and at least four of the patients had acute ischemic strokes because of the injection into the carotids. Impressive was in this paper that the PET scan showed significant improvement, this compared to this, in those patients injected intracarotidly with the mesenchymal stem cells. In the stroke patients, there was an initial small group, a small study in 2010, where five patients were injected intravenously and compared to 25 control, and there was some improvement in the follow-up of the stroke scores. And in a follow-up study, those patients showed, even in the long term, that there was indeed a significant effect of this injection of the mesenchymal stem cells intravenously in terms of the mortality. So less than half of the patients died in the mesenchymal stem cells treated group as compared to the controls. And the more recent study showed also that in the stroke patients, there's a significant improvement in the progression of the scores of the NHSS score, even when the cells are injected after 1 month or up to 6 months following the stroke. And this is very important because it shows a potential for patients that are already affected by a stroke. In this study, of course, as in the others, there was no placebo group, so there are open studies and the results could be to interpret it carefully. About other models of stroke, here's again here, in ALS, which is more close to, in terms of degeneration, to what happens to multiple sclerosis at the late stages, we see that the injection into the spinal cord of mesenchymal stem cells induced a slowdown of the progression in terms of the respiratory function in the ALS core. And most important, when the cells were injected intraspinally, then there was about a triple number of living axons and neurons, which shows that there is a localized neurotrophic effect in those patients with ALS injected in this specific area with the mesenchymal stem cells. So there were much more living neurons in this area as compared to above and below, indicating a local neurotrophic effect of the injected mesenchymal stem cells. And the last one of the studies by Eva Feldman in ALS showed again a transient suppression of the activity of the disease and the progression, especially at periods of 3 months following each injection. So all this led us also to test it many years ago, in the ALS disease. Since from 2006 to 2009, we tested in a group of 19 patients the injection of mesenchymal stem cells intrathecally into the cerebrospinal fluid, and we see there is a mild suppression of the progression. We can say that there's stabilization in these 19 patients, but this was mainly a safety study, open study, and it is important there were no significant side effects except fever, headache, and in one patient, meningism, and some other transient effects of low degree. In the continuation of this trial, we used these enhanced mesenchymal stem cells that produce greater amounts of growth factors, and this was in collaboration with the protocol of Brainstorm company in Israel, and we found that when we have those cells cultured in this way, we can induce three or more times the production of GDNF and BDNF. These are the normal, in blue, the normal mesenchymal stem cells, and these are the enhanced. So we have kind of accelerated production of growth factors, and we tested in 26 patients with ALS. These are the side effects in both phases of this study, very minor, even less than in the previous one that we had with the unmodified mesenchymal stem cells. The progression of the disease before the treatment and after the treatment was changed, at least in terms of the slope of the progression when compared each patient, and it was this was significant in both phases of the trial in terms of the slope of progression of the ALS score and the respiratory function. In another way, we can see as slopes of progression of ALS score or the FVC, and either one of these were in green color at 3 months, and in 6 months it's improved or becoming at least 25% less than the pretreatment values. And so we see that there's a very significant effect in almost all these patients injected intrathecally with mesenchymal stem cells. When the cells were injected into the muscle, we found that there was a big difference between the right injected arm in terms of the compound muscle action potential as compared to the left arm, which was not injected. So what we did in the continuation of this ALS trial, we had some collaboration with three centers in the United States, and the initial data from this double-blind study with 64 patients showed exactly the same data in terms of the effect of the, on the ALS score, and 50% of the patients improved of at least one and a half degree in the ALS score at 1 month. There is now a phase three study with 200 patients running in the US. What happened in the follow-up of the previous patients treated at ADASA, 20 patients of them were followed with multiple injections. This is one, two, three. Some people had, some patients had even four injections. And we see the slopes of, progression before the treatment and after, or in a different way by colors, so we can have the green colors, which are better than previously. And most of the patients have a better rate of progression after each injection of the mesenchymal stem cells. Here is the mean of all the 20 patients followed up for at least now 2 years. And after each injection, we see that there is a stabilization in these 20 patients of the ALS progression and also in the respiratory function. In multiple sclerosis, let's go back to multiple sclerosis, which is the most important part for us. There was one study published in Lancet Neurology about the intravenous injection of mesenchymal stem cells from UK, showing a good indication of some activity, efficacy, in terms of the visual acuity, which improved significantly, and the optic nerve area, which also had, was much different than before the treatment. So there is also some indication of some effect on the EDSS score, but and also in the total volume, volume of the brain. But these were only indications because the study was small. It was only 12 patients. So what we did in our center in multiple sclerosis, we had an initial safety study in 15 patients before 2010, published then. The adverse events were minimal, as we saw, because this was a parallel study with the ALS one. And most of the patients had some significant effects in the clinical parameters of the progression of the disease. Even in the MRI, we've seen in cases that there was a substantial decrease in the lesion load. And when we stained in 9 patients the mesenchymal stem cells with Feridex, the paramagnetic material, there were these black spots in areas of the spinal cord and of the occipital horns, indicating a possible migration of those cells. The immunomodulatory effects of, in the patients included especially an increase of the regulatory cells and the decrease of several inflammatory markers up to 3 months following the treatment with the mesenchymal stem cells. And a longer follow-up of 27 of these patients, 28 patients of them in, with multiple sclerosis, and this is the number of additional injections with mesenchymal stem cells and the years of follow-up, we see that with the exception of 2 patients, mostly they were mostly stable or improved in the progression of the EDSS score. What is happening now, there is a multiple, multiple center study with the intravenous injection of mesenchymal stem cells, the MESEM study, which is about to be concluded in a few months, and also a double-blind study, which was recently completed in the summer in our center in Jerusalem with 48 patients, a phase 2B study. I will show you some of the updated data from this last study with 48 patients, randomization into three groups, intrathecal injection of mesenchymal stem cells, intravenous injection, or placebo. And after 6 months, there was a crossover and change of the treatment group in, in these groups. The demographics of these 48 patients, most of them were with progressive types of multiple sclerosis. Some of them, they had a progressive and relapsing course, but mostly they have either primary or secondary progressive. These are the EDSS score at inclusion. The mean, the average was 5.4, and this is the total 5.6 for the female and male patients. The safety of this study. Until now, we haven't seen any significant side effect. 28 of them had headache, probably related to the injection of the stem cells intrathecally. Some had back pain, but no significant other effects, like three of them had a transient fever. I have to mention here that the blindness was complete for any clinical assessment and the injection of the cells. Each patient, even those receiving the placebo, were performed with a lumbar puncture. Either cell line or stem cells were injected in a black syringe where nothing was could be seen. And this is the interim analysis presented for the first time in this 32 patients. The lock of the data is done exactly after this meeting this week, but we have the interim analysis of the 32 patients, which showed that there is a very big difference between the placebo and the mesenchymal stem cells, almost at 6 months, double efficacy in terms of the stop of the progression in EDSS, and also some borderline additional benefit by the repeated injections. This is happening also to each individual functional scores, which is significant, to the ambulatory scores, the progression very significant, and less than double in the mesenchymal stem cells treated patients. In a graphic way, we can see that all patients treated with placebo at the initial phase had some increase in the EDSS score, and there was a decrease in those patients treated either intravenous or intrathecally with the mesenchymal stem cells. So this is the summary of the interim analysis of these patients. There was a significant decrease in the step of progression in EDSS at 6 months. There was a significant decrease in the change in the ambulatory scores, in the functional scores, and in the relapse incidence. The follow-up includes most further additional tests, which can be, of course, more informative in terms of providing an objective information about the degeneration and regeneration. We have cognitive tests, the 25 feet walking test, the 9 peg hold test, the 4 cognitive tests for the progression of the cognitive functions, the MRI, quantitative evaluation of the MRI volume, functional MRI, resting functional MRI, including all the connectivity of the brain. So we see that in these specific patients, for instance, there is some improvement in all these parameters, and there is a parallel increase in the MRI brain volume and in the functional MRI. And we see that also the dynamic visual tests go in good correlation with the VEP measurements and with the OCT. For instance, the motion perception had some tendency to increase, and the motion perception also in the left eye. And there was this correlation with the VEP latency to the OCT findings of the RNFL. So we have all these measurements, which will include 6,000 pages of information because of the DTI data, the functional MRI, and the dynamic visual tests, including the cognitive functions, which may provide a more objective information about the efficacy of those cells. But there is no good fairy tale without the bad dragon, and I think that we have problems in this application of stem cells to neurological diseases, especially because of the easiness of using mesenchymal stem cells. There are numerous stem cell treatments in non-academic institutions, and the stem cell tourism, which is developed around the internet, and everyone, many of my patients have traveled to China or to Russia or to India to receive this kind of treatments, and sometimes the results are like this, like the catastrophic demyelinating encephalomyelitis after intrathecal injection and intravenous of stem cell transplantation, mesenchymal stem cells. I don't know exactly what happened here. or another case with the development of a tumor with probably injection of embryonic or neuronal type of stem cells. And there are still open questions. We don't know which is the optimal way of administration unless our study will give us a good, clear answer about the additional benefit of the intrathecal versus the intravenous way of administration. We don't know exactly which is the optimal quantity of cells. We don't know which is the optimal way of administration, including novel ways of administration with the intranasal administration, for instance, like in the case of the mouse model, which is effective. And we do not know whether we have to neuralize the cells in a better way in order to enhance them and become more effective. And all these are good indications for the animal models, but have to be proven in the clinical tests. I will finish here, and I want to say that we have a lot of optimism from the current existing knowledge of the clinical application, but we're still in the first step in a long way of finding all these answers to the previous questions and avoiding what's happening now for stem cells in many places, that they use stem cell therapies for everything and can be like the panacea for every disease. So we have to be careful in this, and I want to thank all these collaborators at different stages of our projects and in different places in our center in the world. Thank you very much for your attention.